Hey, everybody. Shane Presley here, Rock Paper Podcast. Thank you for checking out another episode. Today's features Granite City Rockers, Chainlink. Had a lot of fun hanging with them, talking about their debut EP and a whole lot more. Hope you enjoy this one. Do want to remind you, as always, Rock Paper Podcast is brought to you by Friendship Brewing Company in Wentzville, Missouri, serving up all your craft beer needs. Over 25 rotating taps out there. You can come enjoy some of their fine beverages. And they've got some special holiday beers available right now. One's yam, sweet potato. They got pumpkin pie, pecan pie. They got... you can get them as a flight or a four-pack sampler. So come on out and check those out. They sound pretty interesting. And you can get yourself all kinds of delicious food out there at Friendship as well. The specials throughout the week, but you get your burgers and nachos and flatbread pizzas and tacos and all kinds of tasty things. Whatever you're into, I'm sure they've got something perfect for you. And you can get some great live music on Thursdays. They've been doing this Singo Bingo. So Thursday night on December 15th is Golden Oldies. And Friday, December 16th, Denver Wade Trent returns. One of my great friends and always a good time out there. And Saturday, December 17th, Matt Waltershed. You can find all their concert calendar, food menu, and beer menu at friendshipbrewingcompany.com. And also mark the calendar, December 20th. They're hosting a ugly sweater party. So come get festive and enjoy some dinner and beverages at Friendship Brewing Company. And if you are in the Hannibal, Missouri area, great news. Friendship Brewing Company is coming to you, opening a brand new location in 2023. So get plugged in for more info, and I'll be sure to share some details when I know about it. If you need me, of course, you can always find me at rockpaperpodcast.com. Hit me up on the socials. Email me at rockpaperpodcast@gmail.com. And if you'd like to help support the show, a great way to do so would be hitting up the merch store. Got some t-shirts, some hats, tank tops, and check it all out at rockpaperpodcast.com or buyjack.com/rockpaperpodcast, BYJACK.com. And I would love to see you out there wearing your little shiny shirts. That out of the way, sit back, relax, and enjoy a brand new episode with Chainlink.
Podcast is kind of like it's like a radio show that's not on the radio. It's on the internet. Does that make sense?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. That's also like my mom. It makes it sound more confusing, doesn't it? It sounds like this.
We are Chainlink, and this is Rock Paper Podcast.
Rock Paper Podcast.
Scissors beat paper, paper covers rock. Rock beat scissors, Shane covers nonstop. Never know what new kind of guest that he's got coming at you. Live and direct on the spot. Could be rock, folk, country, or hip-hop, jazz. All kind of folks that he has. Could be an artist or a comedian to make you laugh on the
Rock Paper Podcast.
Double-decker fudge round, rolling round town. Shane coming at you live and direct from ground zero. He's your hero, he's your bestie. Rock Paper Podcast with Shane Presley.
Rock Paper Podcast.
Hey everybody, Shane Presley here, Rock Paper Podcast, coming to you from St. Louis, Missouri. Hanging out today with the guys of Chainlink.
Hey, Shane.
Hey.
Hey. How you doing?
Welcome to the show, guys.
Thank you for having us.
This is, thank you. Yeah, this is cool. I'm glad, you know, I've been doing the show a while, and this is still some of my favorite parts, is like getting to continually meet new people making music in our town. And I'm glad it's still happening, man. It's like, it's crazy to think, like, you think that one day you would like get to the end of the list, you know, it's like that I've met everybody or whatever, you know, that, but there's always new bands starting, new projects starting and everything else. So there's never going to be an end of the list. And so it's fun to get to continually meet new people. And that's our case today, man. We just linked up on the socials a little bit ago, and I'm excited to sit down and talk about what you guys have been up to and your brand new EP and everything else. So I guess before we get rolling too far, you guys want to go around and say hi and introduce yourselves?
All right. Hello, my name's Noah. I do guitar and vocals in Chainlink.
Hi, I'm Ben. I play bass in Chainlink.
I'm Jeffrey. I'm the drummer for Chainlink. We're all a bunch of good buddies.
Yeah. Take me back to like the beginning of Chainlink and our as you three come together. I mean, is this did you guys meet through school, or how do we come together?
We met through chance, complete chance, yes. To be honest. We had a mutual friend. He had a birthday party in December, right by Christmas. It was incredibly cold. We're at the fire. They show up. I see them. Somehow music came up. Somehow they were in a band and I wasn't. And I was like, man, do you need guitar? And you know, there's a million people who want to be guitar.
Right.
So, you know, I'm like, okay, I'm disposable. But they're just like, oh, okay, cool. And then we just happened to have a mutual desire. So then I just came over there like the very next day and we did our first jam.
There you go.
So yeah, it was about this time last year.
Yeah. Almost a year now.
I just think it's funny you said fire, and that was the song too. Like one of the songs. So maybe there's something there.
That was not long after me and Ben had met. We were in a class in school for a whole year, and we didn't like interact with each other till about like a couple weeks before school ended. I think he called me Dave Mustaine.
No, yeah, you were the red hair. Yeah, you were the baby Dave Mustaine.
And so, and then he told me he played bass, and then next thing you know, we just started playing together, and we ended up writing a song. We're like, let's put it out. We don't need guitar or vocals.
We don't need a metronome. It's just like
I'd been looking for a drummer for so long, and once I found Jeff, I was like, okay, I can finally do what I need to do now. And we started getting together and we started recording, doing our thing. And then we met Noah in like December. And then we just started practicing as much as we could.
Yeah. Nice. Yeah. What was like, I always kind of find it interesting too. Like, I mean, obviously you guys all come from your own individual backgrounds and influences and stuff. But as you're like, as you know, things start shaping up to be this band, like what is that discussion like? What direction you guys are going to take this sound and stuff? Like, do you guys have that conversation? Like, what kind of music we're going for? What we want to do? And
I think it's a lot of the time we just send each other songs or albums. What if we do something like this in this specific part or that, or and put like a bunch of puzzle pieces together, sure, and find out just like what that would all sound like together.
Yeah, no, I think it's like we all just take pieces of each other's favorite stuff, right, and like we find our own things we enjoy in everything.
Yeah.
So it's like, it's a weird mixture, but I feel like you guys were kind of doing like just a standard like rock and then the metal, and then Ben kind of had the prog thing going on, and then I came and I was like really into punk music. So that kind of, Jeff, I mean, you were into like Remo Drive and stuff like that at the time. There was kind of a connection, but I feel like I kind of ended up feeling that a little bit. But then I also had the prog stuff. But I feel like we're very similar musicians, but like very different still.
Yeah.
Like we fill in the gaps that each other like do not have.
Well, that's like, I mean, that's really the fun of it is, you know, you guys all bring your individual tastes and talents and influences and everything, and you throw it all in a blender and it becomes Chainlink. You know,
yes,
that's like, you know, that's kind of that's what makes everybody stand apart, you know, like you guys are. So, it's fun. It's like a, you know, I know people make comparisons or whatever, you know, like a, you know, cooking or whatever. It's like a dish, you know, you got to, like, it's all the different parts of the recipe and things like that. So, but I think it's fun, man. And like, and that's, people would like talk about too, like sometimes, you know, bringing in a different, you know, another player maybe to join the band, or a different producer or engineer. And that's like the thing, is like, it's just another person to kind of, they bring their same kind of thing, bring their stuff in to make it even a different sound. So, but I think it's cool what you guys got going on. We got, like I said, we got the debut EP. So where does the, you guys, like I said, you only been doing this as this particular lineup now for, since like December last year. So when's the discussion start? Like, hey, maybe we should start recording some of this stuff and make an EP.
Ooh. This run is May?
Yeah.
May, probably. I feel like it was about May.
We had written a couple songs, and we were like, we should just record it. See how, like, what we can, you know, we've already written the song. Let's try and record our own stuff. And that was a challenge.
It was a journey of sorts. Our main issue was that, I knew nothing about mixing drums at all. I'd never mixed real drums or mic'd real drums or done any of that. So I had my faith in Jeff. And honestly, we were all kind of lost in every degree. But in the end, we were able to cobble it together some way. But it was a struggle.
Yeah.
We also realized we're accidentally a prog band too. So, you know.
The writing process was really easy. But then once you got into the recording process, we realized, oh, we need metronomes for these things. And that takes a lot of time to set up. And it's hard to get.
Yeah.
The recording process took a lot of time.
You guys, all this was DIY, all, you know, pretty much?
Spent a lot of time in my basement.
All right.
Yep.
Lots of fully. Mm-hmm. I mean, that being said, it was just to kind of hone our skills and prepare us
for
following releases. I mean, you see a lot of people's journeys in production or writing or anything. I mean, especially in production and like a scene that's very like grassroots, people aren't going to these big studios and putting in like, you know, $50 an hour or whatever. You know, they just kind of have to cobble it together themselves. Mm-hmm. And you see the growth. It's cool. So it's like, we'd like to be able to fit our own image perfectly, but we're going to see our own growth as well.
Yeah. I mean, I totally get it, man. I started this show with a Blue Yeti USB mic, a single room mic, and I started talking to people and had no idea what I was doing. I had no idea how to record or edit or anything, and it took a lot of time and effort, a lot of trial and error, you know, just trying to get it right, trying to get better, you know, honing my own skills and learning how to, you know, speak publicly. But it's like, so the same thing, like you're saying, is like putting that out there to, like, you know, this is where we started. And like, we're going to constantly putting in the work to get better and learn and everything else. So yeah, my first recordings are not exactly, you know, again, I wasn't something I was like, it's just kind of weird now. Like, you know, you go back to listen to that like eight years later and it's like, oh wow, you really can see the growth, you know. And then that's like what's cool to see. It's like, it's fun that it's like there's the starting point and stuff. But I mean, even that you guys just did it all yourself, I guess impressive to get to figure it all out, you know, making it work. And so we got it all together. We got the EP readily available today. And we can find that on all your streaming platforms now. Okay. And let's start with number one. And this is a song called Realize. And what do you guys want to tell me about this one?
Well,
this was probably the first song we wrote all together.
Yeah. Collectively, at least.
Yes. So this does have an original purpose, original reason, an origin story. Right outside of where I live at the time, there is a church sign. And on it, it says, real eyes, realize, real lies. So read the Bible. And It's more of an observation. I mean, I literally say I read that on a church sign. I did read that on a church sign. And I thought it was funny because it's like something you'd read on Tumblr. And they thought it was like good at carrying out the word of God. So it was almost a goof. But it was just a funny little thing. And it happened to line up with the instrumental I was writing at the time. And I was like, ooh, this is cool. And then we really realized, oh man, this song's like kind of complicated for no reason. But it worked out. And it's a very short flurry of things, and then it's over.
Yeah. It kicks you in the teeth.
Track. Shortest song on the EP, but I think it took the longest to record.
It did. Yeah. It did. Yeah, for sure.
What, isn't there like two or three time switches in it?
Yeah.
So
yeah,
we still didn't know how to record.
No, so, that was a rough time.
But yeah, that was after we got through like the first or second time switch, the process kind of picked up. And once we finished, realized it was a lot easier to do the other songs. So, but this is probably one of my favorite songs that we made.
Oh yeah,
and all the work we put into recording it just makes it a little bit feel better when I listen to it.
Oh yeah, mm-hmm. You said what? You said something about TikTok was enjoying this one.
About what? TikTok?
Did you say you put this one on TikTok or something?
Yeah, we put a video of it on TikTok, and of course you get the comments, this sounds like this. This sounds like Converge. And it's like, you know, okay. Okay, but yeah, no, people enjoyed it. I think generally that's one that like a lot of people just click first. It's the first song. It's short, so you can sit through it. You're not going to be like, oh, this is boring, I'm not going to sit through it. But then you have 30 seconds left when you say that, so you might as well sit through it.
Yeah.
And that's just kind of been the song of interest, I guess.
Yeah, I think it's interesting, like, that putting it on the socials like that, and like and then how fast like you can get reaction, and like, I don't know, it's just like, I had a talk with a little while back. I don't know if you guys know, there's they're more Alton, Lofty's Comet.
Have
you guys
met
those guys? They got some attention on like, I guess one of their, some shower thoughts went viral on there or whatever. People were, you know, got a lot of activity for it, and I was just like, I just thought that was super cool that they're making just a silly video of them playing around, and people were like, you know, hopped on board with it. So
the internet's wonderful.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. For those yeah, reasons.
For those reasons.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Yeah. There's I don't know. It's just fun, man. It's fun to get in, especially like that all over the world. You know, it's like, it's just interesting to throw it out there and see what people think of it. So it's cool that you're getting a getting some kind of response from people and stuff. So, but yeah, I think that's supposed to anything. Like, people are going to immediately go to saying it sounds like whatever it is that they know of, you know, it's like, they're going to try to make those connections and
it helps them. It makes them enjoy it more. Yeah. It makes them enjoy it more.
Yeah. So, so again, like I said, this is on your, all your, favorite streaming platforms now, right? Mm-hmm. So we got that out there, and check it out to add to your favorite playlist. And maybe you want to, you know, go to the gym, work out, get pumped up and realize. But let's talk about a song called Slug.
Okay. Slug. So Slug, it started as a jam. It's totally the black sheep of the album, because there's a certain type of mindset we had when we were writing everything. And then Slug was like, guys, this is, you know, it was just the goofy little song.
It was fun. And
we still wanted to stick with it because it was just this good, like, out of left field song. Just a good time. We were just enjoying recording it and everything. And a lot of people, it's their favorite, because a lot of people can't connect with listening to hardcore or connect with listening to prog or whatever. But some people can connect with listening to Foghat or something, you know. Yeah. So, it was just a really fun song to do. I can't say there was a specific, like, purpose or, like, writing process behind it. Lyrics are up on everything, though. Like, I feel like sometimes lyrics come separate from the instrumentals. It's more like, how can I make this complement what's already in the song in a tonal sense? But no, that one all around, it's just a good old fun song.
Yeah, it's good old fun.
We played it and practiced it. It got heavier and heavier, and so now the version that we have sounds nothing like the first jam that we had. It sounded more like a
like porn soundtrack from the 70s. It was really strange, but now it's like a really fun song to play.
And yeah, sure. I remember there was a goal that it had to sound like a truck commercial. Yeah. That was the whole shtick with that song, that it had to sound like we were driving a Ram, and that was the commercial. That was the song in the commercial. That was the whole thing.
Yeah.
It was good.
Yeah. This, I have to agree, or I have to admit that this is definitely one of my favorites. It caught my attention, and I think it's a lot of that guitar lick. Like, it's just fun, and it was, like it was, you mentioned Foghat, reminiscent of a more of a classic rock thing, and I'm obviously a huge fan of a lot of Foghat and all the other era, that era of rock and roll, so it definitely caught my attention for that, too, so... but yeah, it's a fun song, man. It's like, I'm glad that, you guys got it, you figured it out, and like, you know, like, and I think that's a lot of it, just like, you know, it starts with this, that jam, and then just keeps getting, you know, you keep putting like a filter on it, and it keeps getting, you know, different and yeah. And then finally, like, there it is. Now we got it. So, but yeah, man, this turned out real nice. You guys thinking about doing any like music videos or anything like that with this release, or what?
I'm taking a music video production class at Lewis and Clark Community College.
Yeah.
I had to make a music video for a song that was at least 3.5 minutes. The only song on the EP that's over 3.5 minutes is Fire. Mm-hmm. And so... we went up to Godfrey and recorded a music video, and it's different. It's a lot different than playing as loud as you can, especially as the drummer. It was,
and our monitors weren't working. Oh, the audio was busted up, and so we couldn't hear the audio while we were playing, so we didn't know if we were playing in time. And it was just, it was a unique experience for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But
time crunch.
But it was a time crunch. We admittedly chose a kind of strange time to do it, but it turned out all right. Apparently. You played doctor on it and it worked.
We got enough footage for it to all sync up, and it looks pretty good. And I also put some funny effects on it. So, and it fits the song. So
is it? Yeah. Well, that's cool that you're studying this, and
it's I since we recorded the EP, I was really interested in recording audio, and I my high school had a program to like that I could register for college early, and this community college had like a music program that I was really interested in. I've been going for a couple months now, and I just love it. Mm-hmm. I have my professors are a lot of fun. I'm in a classes with a bunch of other guys in bands. So it's, we bounce off of each other, all these ideas, and it's just a lot of fun.
Yeah. Yeah. I got some buddies that, you know, are very active in the music scene, and, they are high school teachers or college, you know, professors and stuff. And I just think it's cool, like, when their students, like, support them, too, like, in their original bands and stuff. It's just kind of, it's kind of a fun relationship, like, that they have like that. And so I don't recall any of my, I mean, at least, well, I had one high school teacher that had a band. I never got to see his band, but I remember talking about it with him and stuff. But I don't know. I just think that'd be kind of be fun to see your teacher being a rock star up there and stuff, you know, so. But I wish I would have, you know, not like I said, doing the show now, like I've really become passionate about like trying to record and get a nice solid recording of these live acoustic songs and stuff. A lot of times I only do the acoustic because like it's the only thing I can feel confident to actually get sound right. And I haven't got enough equipment yet to do like a full band stuff yet. So, yeah. But one day we'll get there. That's the goal. But I've been having fun with this, and like, you know, I'm proud of what I've been able to record, and I kind of wish I would have And not that it's ever too late, but I wish I would have, years ago, gone into classes like that and I actually studied. Maybe I could have, been a producer or engineer or whatever, something like that. But I don't know. It's fun to do now as a hobby, but kind of, and I think about that maybe like, I don't know, that maybe it wouldn't be as fun if I was getting paid to do it all the time or whatever, but there's probably pros and cons to all of it. But I don't know. I just I feel like it always kind of works out for the right reasons, you know. It's like it's bright. So, but anyway, I don't know. I think it would. I'm glad to hear you guys are, you're finding that creative lane to get to apply some of these things and maybe continue to learn more skills and get better at video and audio and everything. And it's nice to have it all, especially like in today's, where it's a lot of like DIY. It's like nobody's got the money. Absolutely. We don't have any money to pay all these people to do it. So it's, if we can do it all in-house, if we got a guy that, is good at graphics or good, engineer or video and everything else, it's like, it's just nice to do it all in-house here. So, it's cool to see you guys making it happen. Let's talk about the next track. This is House of Pigs.
Okay. So I guess this is kind of, it's interesting because this is definitely lyrically the most personal one, but with the instrumentals and everything, it was very like impromptu. I remember I was playing something and he was like, oh, and he referred to it as the cool riff for about 2 weeks before he made it into something. And it was just like it was equal contribution from everybody. I feel like that was definitely our, like we all took our liberties and it worked out. It was just a really fun song to make. But and the meaning of a song, oh man. So this is a crazy story. I don't know. Okay. So basically, my stepdad, he has passed, but he okay. So he left these pigs. We had these pet pigs in my childhood. And they were not really mini pigs. That's the thing. When they sell you pigs, they're lying, usually. From what I understand, they just turn into these huge animals. So that was not a very good long-term plan. Regardless, nobody wanted to take care of them. And it got really bad. I moved out of the house. Anyways, apparently he just left them in the garage. Forgot. Just done.
That's, yeah.
Crazy. Crazy stuff happens.
Yeah.
And it was just like, it was melodramatic. But it's like, I don't know. It's like where I am now versus where I was there. I mean, I was really young. I don't even think I was really exposed to it. I don't think I understood it. But now that I understand it, I'm still just like, I don't know. It's not even necessarily about me. It's something I observed in the world, you know? So even though it should affect me, I didn't really understand it. So it's more my observation of it, I guess. So yeah. It's a really strange thing to write about.
All right.
It's interesting. But we got a cool song out of it.
You got a cool song out of it, though.
Face
I think it works out pretty well.
Definitely the favorite. Yeah. Right? It's the favorite.
I think the favorite of the band.
Definitely the best song. Perform, like, I feel like we all did our best on that song. Without a doubt.
That's understandable.
If there was like one thing to encapsulate us and who we are as musicians, it's that song.
And playing it live, it's one of those songs that has a lot of energy, not only from us, but from the crowd.
God, the live setting is studio is nothing compared to how it is live, I'll tell you.
Yeah, you well, let's we do have a live date on the calendar coming up. You guys are playing a house show, right? Basement kind of thing.
Yeah.
This is at the G Spot.
The G Spot. The G Spot of Alton.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In January 21st.
I think so.
Yeah. I have it on my calculator. We can give it a calculator. calendar, not my calculator. That should not work. Well, we have it set for the. Hold on. Did I not put it on my. Oh, wait.
You can just check the.
Yeah, Instagram. Yeah.
There we go.
I got DMs. Wonderful.
I'm sure it's.
Okay, 21st. Yep, 21st. Just wanted to make sure.
Yeah, man. That'd be fun. Yeah, and so we don't know who all on that lineup yet, but you guys will be there. And those are fun, man. I've been a part of a couple of different, you know, things like that, house parties, and like it's just fun to, you know, getting a real intimate kind of show like that, you know, and a unique experience to see a band right up and close and personal like that. So getting weird and getting loud. So it's going to be a fun night.
The crowds are just great. The crowds are great. It's the energy. That's what's wonderful. Yeah. Everybody's just enjoying the music.
Everybody's right in front of your face, you know, like right there.
Well, I remember I was at a house show. We were in the basement, lowest ceilings, like lower than this basement. But being the tallest person in a mosh pit, especially in that basement, was not the best idea. I hit my head pretty hard on an air conditioning vent. And the band that was playing Inner City Witches, they saw it. And when they stopped their song, they asked me if I was okay. And I said, I'm good. And their bassist, Alan, he's like, "You okay, man? I got to hug this guy after the show." And I just walked up to him and hugged him right on the spot. And now we're just really good friends. So it's crazy how stuff like that works out. But
right.
The connection.
Yeah.
The connection. Yeah.
What was your guys' first live show as a band?
That was
CBGB.
CBGB with Tom Thanks and Equipment from Ohio.
Oh, yeah.
Was that in August?
Late August.
August 17th, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah. And yeah, the CBGB was great. It was just like, it kind of has that similar house show vibe in a sense, because it's a very tight, packed little corridor of sorts, and everybody's just lined up. There's the pinball machine. Going wild. People are swinging against each other. Drinks are spilling. It's a great time. It was fun.
Yeah.
We got to open up for Equipment. I believe they're from Ohio. I don't know. Mm-hmm. But they were great. They were awesome. And Tom Thanks, of course. Tom Thanks, they're awesome. It was a great introduction. We had a really great time.
Yeah.
That was a great first show, for sure. A lot of people came. It was tight. It was
we were really close. So many friends from the scene came out. Blake Mickens from Inches from Glory, he came out. Joe Webb.
Shout out to Joe, biggest fan.
Biggest
Chainlink. He's been at pretty much every show, I think, except for our last show where he got stuck in traffic, and his phone, he lost his phone, and then it was a whole situation.
Sounds like a Joe situation.
Yeah.
Man, that I guess I don't know, that's just it's pretty wild, like, to think about, like, you know, you guys even to get to there, you know, it's like a lot of people don't even leave the basement. You know, people are scared to get out there and perform publicly and stuff. And there's so many talents. People just like get stuck in their bedroom or whatever, just playing guitar. And like, so like, it's cool that you guys got out there and you're doing it. We got that show, and hopefully we'll get some more things. I mean, is touring something you guys want to get out there and like travel around next year?
Everybody wants to, but not everybody can. Sure. Here's the thing. Summer's coming up. I don't know how that would happen. If we had the possibility, of course we would. Of course we would. But that would probably be the only time where we'd have the capacity to do that.
Yeah.
That being said, that would be cool. I think that's a lot of people's dreams, but it's also, of course, very difficult. It's strenuous.
Yeah, sure.
But yeah, no, touring would be great. But back on the regard of, I guess, getting to that point, getting out of the basement, I think the biggest thing people need to know is just to like send that stupid email, send that DM.
Oh, yeah.
That's just like two sentences. I don't care if it's two sentences. As long as you like seem kind of nice and you kind of, you know, are very clear with what you want, you'll probably get a response and you'll probably get a show. They'll give you a shot.
Mm-hmm.
I think usually you just got to send a lot of them. Like, you know, bring it back to like college. If someone's in college, I mean, you're going to send an email to your professor. Same thing. Be like, hello, this is da da da. This is what I want. Thank you at the bottom. There you go. Email that to everybody, every single venue, every single person you want to talk to, and you get what you want. You get what you want because I think everybody else would do the same. If I got a cool email from somebody wanting something from me, like I'll help.
Yeah. I agree, man. That it doesn't hurt to ask, and the worst they can do is say no. And it's like, but yeah, if there's something you want, go for it, you know, try it. And so yeah, I agree. And I think like as a person that receives emails, like there's a lot to it just being properly, like I've had a couple like here and I'm like, what is it? Like, what is this? You know, it's like, you know, like at least like introduce yourself or like, you know, something like that, like kind of thing. It's like, but so I've got some weird emails and I'm like, and they might be great. You know, it's like, I do try to listen to if people send me any kind of music, I do try to listen to like everything they, because maybe there is something great in there, but it's like, but there's something about like even just presenting the way you come off and present yourself, especially like the fact that if I don't know you at all and you're sending me just a random link and stuff, like,
here's my house.
Right. Yeah.
Here. You know, like,
yeah, but it should be like, at least like, hi, I'm, you know, we're Chainlink. We're, you know, we're doing this or whatever. It's like, it's all part of the package. You got to present yourself right. Mm-hmm. So people want to give you those opportunities. And so, yeah, I don't know. It's just funny though, but yeah, I agree, man. Like putting the work in, putting those emails out there and getting, you know, people are going to want to help out. Like it's especially like a younger band getting started and things like this is, people are excited about given opportunities and stuff. So I'm glad to see, that, you know, CBGB and another, you know, Red Flag, you guys got to throw down over there a while ago. And, you know, it's like, there's been some fun opportunities to get into play some of these stages around town now. So,
yeah.
That Red Flag's that's a cool space. I like that room a lot.
Oh yeah.
That was a great show. Shout out to every single band who played with us. Honestly, it was all great. Shout out to Non-Euclidean Geometry. Shout out to Native Living. Shout out to No Wake. It was the weirdest.
Those are my dudes. I like No Wake a lot.
No Wake. Yeah, they're fun. Great. They're great guys.
Yeah. They put on a show.
Yeah. They put really on a show. Did. I mean, like, here's the thing. It was a different vibe. You know, they were the audience was almost split. You had the college kids and then you had the folks who were kind of lingering around,
yeah,
you know, their friends and family and then other people. But then there was people who were coming in generally for the show.
Right.
But it was cool to see these groups mingle and connect because No Wake had their own posse and then we had all of our people. And it was awesome because everybody came together. I think everybody was just enjoying every single set. And that's the thing that I think I notice a lot more now compared to in the past was everybody's trying to work together and help each other out. And they all want each other to succeed.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And that's really cool.
For sure, man. Yep. Yeah, I do feel like St. Louis as a whole is pretty good about that. Like, we might have little pockets and where we kind of, like, stay in our own lane sometimes. There's not a lot of – but it seems like everybody's genuinely supportive. You know, it's like it's – for the most part, I've experienced that, like, people would genuinely want the best for everybody. Nobody – like, there's not – there's only, like, I don't know, for a while there was, when I was first introduced to, like, St. Louis music, it was through, like, the Battle for Point Fest stuff, and it was a lot of competition, and it was, like, it was a lot of that, like, where, art, you know, you went up and you watched your buddy's band play, but then everybody, like, left the room because they didn't want to support the other band because it was, you know, you wanted to show your support for just your band because that was it was this competition thing. So I feel like kind of getting away from the competitive side of it like that, that it has definitely been more genuinely supportive and collaborative and since so.
The battle of the bands thing is just unproductive. Yeah, I feel like there's just such a better way to do it. There's such a better way to do it.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. I mean, like it's but I don't know. It's the way they did it then. And I don't know, but yeah, I agree. I don't think music should be competitive. It's all art, it's all subjective, it's all open to it.
It's just human nature wanting to be competitive.
Yeah.
But yeah. Right. Art doesn't It doesn't work like that. Yeah. So,
yeah. Well, let's talk about the last track on this EP. And you said this is kind of been around for a bit. But we've reworked it and everything. But this song called Fire, and closing out the EP.
So Ben and I wrote Fire about a year and a half ago. Not long after we met, and we tried to record it over and over again. We'd little interface, three microphones on the drums. Ben was plugged in right into the interface. Yeah. Recorded it on GarageBand, and I'm proud of what we did with all the equipment we had.
Right, for what we had. I mean, we had a two-piece thing going on, and we were into that, and we made fun.
Really into Royal Blood at the time. Yeah. I was like, yeah, they can do it. We can too.
Right.
Right.
so that we knew what we were doing with it on the EP versus the single.
Nice. It's an awesome song,
though. Yeah.
We did so much with it, especially at the end, because it does sound different at the end now, but the really guitar just added a different texture, and I feel like we took some liberties on this version and tried to change a little bit. Mm-hmm. Like just maybe a general feel difference, maybe. Right.
The structure of like the song is the same, but it definitely flows differently.
The addition of guitar and vocals, definitely. They don't
Got a grid.
Obstruct what the drums and bass were doing in the first place. It's just like the cherry on top almost. It's that sweet spot that makes that song just so much better. And I love it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, and you said you filmed some footage for the video. Is that something we'll be seeing soon or?
Some point.
Yeah.
Some point. Yes. I don't know when the project is due.
Right.
Oh. that's something to know.
But it'll be done.
Yeah.
And we'll put it out when it is.
Very cool.
So.
Yeah.
Be ready.
Yeah. Excited. Well, you can Chainlink on your Instagram. Follow along there for that video. Hopefully we'll see that video there and some more dates and all the other fun stuff. And at Chainlink _STL.
_STL.
Yeah. Yep. And you got the link tree set in the bio, so you can find all things Chainlink there. And like I said, spin the EP on all your digital platforms, wherever you're getting your music at today. Is there any plans to do any physicals with this? Do you guys think about a CD or tape or anything like that?
We thought about a CD. It was kind of late. We had already had the EP ready to be put out on stores.
Coinciding with our show, we thought
about doing CDs, it was already a little too late.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We didn't have time. But I think we might put some stuff out. I don't know what yet, because my idea with merch was like I wanted to wait until someone asked if we had merch to kind of know that people would possibly get it and be interested and use it. Because, I mean, here's the thing. Merch isn't necessarily for profit. Merch is marketing. Oh, yeah. Merch is marketing for sure, because you're having other people market for you for free.
Sure.
And they're proud of it. And it's cool. It's cool. I do that for other people. I mean, we just like to market our friends. So, I mean, you know, it was in consideration. I don't know when that would be, whether it's music or just silly shirts or something. Yeah. But, yeah, no. I mean, CDs may be a good first step.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I talk about it a lot. I like having a physical product, if nothing else, just to pay for it. And that way it's right in your pocket, even though I might stream on Spotify or whatever more than I actually listen to the CD version or whatever, but at least I paid for it and I want to, you know, support you guys and that kind of thing. So, you know, but I also feel like a t-shirt is a very, you know, good way to do that too. You know, like I said, there doesn't always have to be a physical representation of the music and stuff, but just ways that people can, and, you know, support and pay for the music and everything else and get you guys out there to make more music and, or do other fun stuff. So,
we are making music.
Yeah.
You're producing music.
Definitely.
Well, let's talk about, I got a couple questions for you guys. I like to get to know you all a little bit better with some of these and, been having fun with them, but, all right. What about a song that always gets stuck in your head or maybe most currently stuck in your head? What did you get? Any of you guys, wake up humming along to something?
Oh man.
That's a tough one. Busted by the question.
I don't know. Somebody I saw a video and, somebody shared, I don't know if you guys watch it, but Bo Burnham's, Inside special.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
That's a good one.
It's one of my favorite things. And so just recently this week, I saw somebody playing like an acoustic version of FaceTime with my mom. So then of course I was like, well, I guess I have to go listen to it again. Cause it's been a little bit. And, so I've had like that soundtrack, FaceTime with my mom and stuff like stuck on my, you know, or a white woman's Instagram. I've had these like songs like on a loop in my brain lately, like So that's where I'm at.
You're bringing back the memories of it being stuck in my head when I first watched it. Yeah, that was a really good little movie.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. If you haven't watched that, go check that out. That's it.
So what'd you get floating around in your head?
What's going on? Oh, man. You know, I don't know.
No.
Do you got anything?
Okay. I just remembered this. Oh. When we were eating breakfast this morning, I had Schism by Tool stuck in my head.
That's very
cool. It was very strange. We were surrounded by old ladies in this diner.
Oh, and a guy whipped out some hot sauce on us.
He whipped out hot sauce out of nowhere. Just like it was like a holster or something.
Yeah. He asked for hot sauce. He wasn't even faced.
Fastest hands.
Didn't say a word.
Was it a server?
Yeah, no, I mean, they were just...
Or just a guy. Like,
no, there's no guy. There's no guy just carrying around hot sauce. But
I wish. That would be cool.
They're really good. They're always the best when they just... They say no words. They're no... Just purely business. Purely business. There's no pleasantries. They give you the hot sauce. They leave.
Yeah.
Just like that. That being said, that is completely off topic.
But I had Tool stuck in my head.
You had Tool
the whole time. The whole hot sauce.
I'll throw a song out. Oh man, Parasitic Cleanse by Hail the Sun.
I was gonna. That's insane.
The hottest breakdown of all time.
I was gonna say.
You know what I'm saying?
I was gonna say. I always have Tool stuck in my head, but Hail the Sun's been one of those things that I've been thinking about for a while now.
Yeah, yeah.
They're like really teeny bopper Tool.
Yeah, kinda.
All right. What about? The day comes along, we have a Chainlink action figures. What would you guys like to see as your accessories to go with your action figure?
I know.
Figure?
Wow. This is perfect. Oh, with our action figure. Okay.
Yeah.
Ben, do you got to have Maynard the Goat?
Oh, I think
Maynard the Goat
come with me.
Can Maynard the Goat have his own action figure?
Yes. Are you sure? Does it come with like, it could go with like the stack though, you know what I'm saying?
It could.
Like I need me, obviously.
So explain Maynard the Goat. I don't know. I'm not well versed in the lore of Maynard the Goat.
Okay, so Maynard the Goat. There was a metal like piece, a metal goat. It was a landscape
front yard decoration. You know, that it's my just grandmother had. To
be there to look cool.
Yeah,
and we thought to spray paint it hot pink because why not? You know, whatever. And we named it Maynard because that's fun. And Maynard is our little mascot that sits by the amps and gives us. Good luck.
We also like to move it around while someone's not around. Just like, it's like the elf on the shelf kind of thing. How did the goat get on the table? You know, stuff like that.
Oh, it's stupid.
So you'd have Maynard?
I would have me, obviously. I would have the bass that I'm using at the time, my stack, and probably Maynard on the stack. Maynard's got to be in there.
See, I would go the superhero route.
Really?
Yeah. Drums would be like my Iron Man armor.
Okay.
And then it'd be a helmet you could take off, and then it'd be me and my pretty face.
Do you have a cape? Like cymbal pauldrons and such?
Yeah, yeah.
Do you have a cape, though?
Ooh, that's a good idea.
Oh. You have your drum rug.
Yeah, there we go.
And it goes and it extends on into your drums.
It's the nastiest, dirtiest.
That would be my thing.
It's perfect.
Yeah.
Oh, what about you? What about you?
Me?
About you? Yeah.
Oh, man.
Noah's action figure.
That's like a...
What's going on?
That takes me back when you guys got me Walter White in a jar for my birthday. Man, I don't know. I'd have the guitar, but I got to have something that's like a little bit different.
Yeah, something that's like connects like you.
Connects to me, guitar, man.
You know.
Dude. I got nothing. I mean, hold on.
Well, if you guys had to make a Noah one, what would you put on?
That's tough.
Yeah.
I don't even know that.
I'm just a normal dude. Frankly,
I don't know. He's got to be some dude with like a tie dye shirt.
Yeah.
You know, he's grooving. What I mean?
Well, a ski. Get me a ski. Yeah. Get me a ski.
Yeah. A can of ski in his hand.
A can of ski.
Let's see.
And my Jimi Hendrix shirt.
Right.
Get me the Cracker Barrel hat.
Yeah.
No,
you gotta have that.
That's perfect. I think that all adds up,
there
right?
There you go.
I'm just some guy. He's a superhero. He's a drum man. You have a goat, and I'm...
Yeah, I support Maynard.
I guess I'm a hippie.
Perfect.
That's a wonderful question.
Yeah.
I love that.
Yeah, it's just silly to think about. That's fun. All right. What about a dream duet or collaboration? A certain person, vocalist, instrumentalist, or anybody that you would want to bring in into the mix sometime?
We got to shoot for the stars on this.
Oh, yes, you want to do something really high up.
We can shoot for this. Okay.
Collective answer, like one person.
One person. We would be on the same wave.
We just have one person come in and do like one thing on the song, like vocals or something.
Okay.
My vote is Snoop Dogg. I think that would be just amazing.
He's just amazing.
Yes. Well, I think about it. Like our music, and then Snoop Dogg's throwing down rhymes on top of it.
It just happens. It just works. It just
and
works.
We'd get to hang out with him.
That's true. That is that they're.
Yeah.
They're,
yeah. I wasn't expecting it, but it's welcome. It's welcome. Yeah. I mean, I can understand it. I can understand the it's desire.
Input. Yeah.
He is. It's pretty remarkable his career and the fact that, like, he's been doing it this long. And still just as relevant,
yeah.
Hangs out with everybody, like, you know, even Martha Stewart and everybody, you know, it's like, whatever. It's just like, it's just crazy to think about, man. He's done it all in his career. He's just the coolest, man. He's Snoop. So
he's got Instagram figured out. He just sits there and posts like funny clips and people just, you know, people are just like, how are you doing, Snoop? Good, good. He just posts just clips all day and people just love it. I mean, he knows how to stay relevant. He's got it locked in for sure.
Yeah. 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 He's that would definitely be a fun hang getting Snoop on the track.
You're just bewildered. Where did that come from, Jeff? That had
no as soon as he asked the question, that was where my brain went to.
I
haven't thought about that ever before. But it was just like it was my heart telling me, man.
Photoshop for like Dave Grohl or something. You know?
Yeah, and he's got to do his own thing. I love him to death. Favorite person in the world. But he'd steal all my mojo.
Yeah.
That's fair. Man, that's true.
Yeah. All right. I was thinking about it. Like, I don't know. We didn't really like talking too much. You know, I was thinking about it as you guys were going around with your superheroes stuff, like your instruments, and we didn't really get into it then at the beginning of the story, but like what about that when do you guys pick up your instruments? Like, where was that your family's influence you guys to want to play, or did was that just where does that story start for you guys?
Well, I played various instruments in my childhood. I think the very first one I played was guitar, but I was like 7 and I was just like, what is this thing? And I put it down and then I played video games, you know? So I was just gone. I was gone. I was not having it. So for years I tried different instruments. I tried clarinet, piano, da da da, all these different things. And eventually I came back to guitar. My mom played guitar. I mean, she was just kind of like a chord strummer.
Yeah.
And, but her guitar was always just sitting around. So I remember I was just walking through the house and I was like, I'm going to try this. I picked it up. Couldn't do it. But I was like, I'm going to stick to this. I'm going to see where this goes. So I took it with me, took it home, practiced, 3 years. So about 3 years ago, I finally stuck to it. I don't know why I said I was about 12. I was about 14. So 17.
Yes. Nice.
Good stuff. I got my first guitar when I was probably like 7 or 8. It was Mini Fender Strat with like the oldest Mustang that you've ever seen, and I played it for a little bit, and then I picked up a bass because my dad played bass for a while in a band. He's did his own thing, and I was like, okay, I want to play bass. And that started a couple years ago, like right before quarantine started. And then I was playing bass all throughout quarantine, like 8 hours a day, like trying to learn as many songs as I could. And then I was switching to like guitar for a couple months and playing drums for a couple months. But like bass is my thing. Like that's for sure. I've been playing that for years. Yeah.
I started banging on pots and pans when I was 3 years old. I got my first drum kit when I was in the 6th grade. Played that for about a year.
totally like destroyed it. Like the heads and the cymbals. It was all the starter kit stuff, really like cheap cymbals, and they were all bent. And I asked my mom if we could go get some new heads or cymbals for it, and she didn't want to. And so I kind of stopped playing it for a little while, and then out of nowhere, she sold it, my drum kit, because I wasn't playing it. And so I just kind of drums went away for like 2 or 3 years. I didn't even really think about it. And my friend, he asked, he was cleaning out his basement. He was like, hey, do you want this old drum kit that's been sitting down here for like 10 years? And I was like, yeah. And so I went and picked it up, and you know, I changed the heads on it myself, and I got new cymbals myself, and I've been playing that for I think 4 years now. I've been like just playing drums like most of the time. Yeah. So
yeah, that's cool, man. So you still have that, that's, is that that kit or
that is Noah's, that's kit. Noah's kit. I brought my cymbals over.
Okay.
Yep. I work at a store in town, and yeah, they just always had great stuff, Yamaha kits, and it was within our range, and I was like, oh, Yamaha, and it's like the bright yellow, bright yellow.
It is my favorite color.
Yeah.
So I do like playing on this kit and a lot.
All right. Yeah, that's cool, man. I wish I, again, you know, going back to the music stuff, I wish I would have stuck with it too. Like, I don't know. I never had that, you know, something calling, tell me, hey, pick up a guitar or drums or whatever. I just never had that natural, you know, pull towards anything. Like I tried in like sixth grade, we had like, you know, you can kind of like go out for the school band thing. And I think I tried, I played a cornet for a while, and like, I wasn't good. And I don't know why I picked that, but I was just like, I'll try this. And I remember my band teacher saying something like, I'm going to either have to try really hard, or I can go back to gym class, because that was like the option at the time. Like, and I was like, okay, well, I'll see you later. And like, you know, so, So I went back to gym, and I was like, obviously, I've been this big since like the eighth grade. So I was always, you know, basketball and football and everything else, been sports have been much better to me. But yeah, I don't know. I was kind of bummed that I wish I would have, you know, maybe applied myself, took some lessons, or, you know, done something younger. But maybe I've always kind of had this thing, like my dad played a little bit harmonica when I was a kid, and I enjoy watching various harmonica players around town. And like, so something, maybe there's something there. Maybe I can start picking up, getting better at that. But I don't know. I need to apply myself. It's just kind of hard to fit it into the schedule today with everything else. You know, it's kind of hard to like find the time to like really sit down and learn a new instrument, but I would like to someday. I probably should have done that during quarantine. That probably would have been a good time when there wasn't a whole lot happening.
The right instrument will pull you towards it. You'll want to.
Right.
That's how you get good.
Yeah. Sure. But I don't know. Also, I feel like maybe my role is just being a fan. I just enjoy watching, you know, appreciating everybody else playing. But I don't know. Maybe someday. I do feel like I talk about it quite a bit on the show, but like I'm real big into lyrics and songwriters and stuff. And I think about that a lot. I think it'd be fun to get involved in songwriting and stuff. So maybe someday. But let's see. I got a couple more for you guys. And what about if you guys could get into the Guinness Book of World Records for something? What do you guys think it might be? Is there a
longest bass solo?
Yeah.
Thanks. Yeah. Man, I don't even know.
That was easy.
I don't have any like fun talents like that that could go and I guess I could grow out my fingernails. A doctor told me that my fingernails grow faster because I drink more milk than most people. So I guess that's what I have to go for. I don't know. I just fun fact.
Yeah. Oh, fun.
I don't know.
Oh, fun. Jeff's gonna grow out his fingernails. Just to grow out your fingernails.
I'm gonna do that just for you now.
All right. Do it. You won't be able to hold a drumstick. Yeah. Man, I don't know. Let's see. Shortest song. Shortest song.
Just to spite you. Just to spite you.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Longest song. We can't do longest song. That's the issue. The way I write music, I write stuff so short because I put so much information in a single space. I write really dense music.
No, you really do.
Like, I'm playing rhythm and lead. I'm doing all this stuff. And I just don't have any more room to write more because I'm just going to forget the other stuff. So I just end up writing all this really short music. I don't mean to. But recently we've been venturing out and writing some more ambitious stuff. The songs take longer. We have to practice them for longer.
Oh, yeah.
What may have taken a day may take a few practice sessions or, a few weeks even, if we really put our time into it.
And I find that every time we go back to go through the song again and we get to the parts we change are they feel like they fit more. The stuff we add in, it just, it feels more like the song itself instead of
ideas.
Practicing. It sounds like, oh, that belongs. That sounds like that needs to go there, and whatever you're doing sounds cool.
Our writing process is just generally, it's just us staying out of each other's own lanes, but trying to complement each other. And I'll bring a whole idea or whatever, but it doesn't mean it'll sound good or work. So then we'll just be dissecting it, taking pieces I like this. Let's start with that. And then does that transfer well into this? And we're just moving around little puzzle pieces. And eventually it comes out to something that works all right. We've totally shifted structures for songs we're working on right now just because we didn't like how it sounded before. Yeah. What used to be set is not. It's good to sit on the songs for a little while and find out what works.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, I think that's the same. Even you guys have the EP out, but it's like a timestamp. I think it's just a good way to where you guys are at the time. It doesn't even mean that, when you play these songs live, they could be totally different than what you guys have recorded. And you add little things, you get better at your instrument and everything else. And it just, these songs continue to evolve even, to later on. So it's obviously I probably playing pretty close to what you guys recorded, but it doesn't mean they can't change and stuff. Yeah. It's always evolving. So
I'm not gonna lie, we take a lot of liberties on Slug. We try to enjoy ourselves while we're playing it. Yeah. So we really mess with it. But it's fun. It's fun because we have a few videos where we're just doing stuff and somebody in the audience will just be like,
it's kind of like our
why did they do that?
Yeah, it's different for sure.
It's just, we just kind of mess around, have a good time, and it's I think Slug's one of those songs that you haven't heard it before, but you've heard it before.
Yeah,
it's a song that exists. Sure. It's a song that exists for sure.
Yeah,
and so we just kind of try to just have it be our jam almost.
It's saying it's kind of like a crash test dummy of a song,
like a sound check type of thing.
Throw it at the wall. See, I don't know. We just do just whatever, and see how close we can make it sound to the original. That's kind of what it feels like, at least to me.
Yeah, no, I get it.
When you said crash test, I mean, I thought of that song, that silly song they do that. I don't know, you guys from the 90s. That's
I'll be honest. I don't.
That's the entire chorus. It's just. Hmm. Once there was this girl who got
I don't know.
Guys, got
I'm going to trust you. Hold on. Is the name of the song?
That's the name of the song is
Oh. I thought it was Crash Test Dummies, the band?
That's the band, yeah.
Okay, I gotcha. Okay. I'll keep that note.
I feel like I should get more note. Into them.
They're kind of basically a one-hit wonder sort of thing in the 90s.
I gotcha.
I hear it a lot on my satellite radio, 90s on 9.
That'll happen.
You guys will realize how close I was.
I'm going to be honest, I wasn't expecting it to be almost like Creed.
It's actually a really messed up song, the lyrics.
Oh, God. Actually, I don't know. That sums up the 90s.
All right, here we go. Here comes the chorus. Yeah, shout out
to the next song.
Yeah. Stuck in my head. Shout out Crash Test Dummy.
Yep. So anyway, that's where my mind went as soon as you said that. And instead of the actual Crash Test Dummy. That's awesome. Yeah. That's silly song, silly stuff. But it's really like there's a lot of like sad, you know, stuff in the lyrics. Like it's for such a strange song, but and the fact that it's like became a big hit for a while, I guess. There's 140 million download or plays on Spotify for that song. So
I think like Third Eye Blind, you know.
Yeah.
Semi Charmed Life. That's a really sad song. That's a really huge song.
So popular.
It's a huge song, but it's really sad.
Yeah. Yeah. It was a
good song.
Crystal Meth will lift you up, right?
Yeah.
That's what he says. Yeah. That's funny that there's a pop song about doing drugs, crystal meth.
But the 90s were a certain time. People were finding their way to get around it.
Yeah.
But also, that I think that's just how Third Eye Blind was. They played with the juxtaposition of sound and words.
Sure.
They did a lot of heavy topics for like their mostly poppy songs.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I enjoy that kind of stuff. I mean, like, but it's funny as a fan of lyrics, like how many people will get it, kind of forget, like, oh, it's a fun song. And it's like, what? Yeah, but I mean, music wise, but lyrically, you know, if you listen to what he's saying, it's not so fun. But yeah, I do appreciate that juxtaposition like that. So, yeah. Again, you can find Chainlink on your socials. Get plugged in with them on Instagram and TikTok, and come out to the G spot, right?
Yeah.
On January 21st. Yeah. What he said, if you can find it, you can.
If you can find it, we'll be there.
Yeah. We'll be there. We'll be waiting.
Yeah. This has been cool. I really had a lot of fun with you guys today, and I'm excited to see what's next for y'all. I'm guessing you said you guys are, practicing and stuff. I'm assuming we'll have some more new tunes coming soon.
Of course,
yes. Yeah. It's in the works. It's in the works. We're getting adventurous. We're doing new stuff.
A little heavier.
Yeah.
Longer songs.
Yes.
A lot of things to be excited about.
Yeah.
Yep.
Well, yeah. Well, hopefully we can circle back around and do another one of these with the. Some more new music coming soon, so but appreciate you guys doing this today, and hopefully we can catch you at a show here soon and get a little rowdy and try not to smash my head into an air conditioner vent. So
yeah.
But thank you guys.
Thank you for having us. This was a lot of fun.
Yeah. All right. Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Peace. Bye.